One way to create affordability is by building subsidized affordable housing. We decide via a lottery who gets to live in these homes based on the area median income. Traditionally, we built housing for people earning 55% AMI, as deemed by the federal government's tax credit program. More recently, San Francisco has started to subsidize middle-income earners making as much as 140% AMI. The dollar amounts from AMI, based on how big the household is available online at the Mayor's Office of Housing website. Subsidized affordable housing gets built a few different ways. First, the city requires market-rate housing projects to pay for subsidized affordable units. The market-rate housing builder can either do that by building the units in the larger building, making it a mixed income. They can buy land and build a 100% subsidized affordable housing project nearby. They can acquire a building nearby and turn ownership over to the city, or they can pay a fee. That fee is used with other public dollars, leveraged with federal tax income credits, to have 100% subsidized affordable housing builders create 100% subsidized affordable housing projects. Leveraging those fees to build 100% subsidized affordable housing can bring tremendous benefit. However, it's no less expensive to build compared to market rate housing. These two buildings are literally across the street from each other in San Francisco. Can you guess which one is subsidized affordable? As one builder put it, the only thing cheap about subsidized affordable housing is the rent charged to tenants. For the on-site option, the debate is around the percentage of subsidized affordable housing required in large mixed-income housing projects. While that percentage is important, the number can be deceiving, and it's not as important as the final number produced. As the economy improved coming out of the late 2000s, more homes were built in 2014 compared to 2011. As a result, more subsidized affordable units were also built. But the subsidized affordable homes, as a percentage of the total homes built, decreased from 52% to 21%. The danger of setting the requirement is too high is that projects may become economically infeasible and result in no additional housing for anyone. Understanding how building housing impacts displacement is critical. The data shows that market rate housing does decrease low-income displacement. This should not be the only anti-displacement strategy, but it's part of the puzzle.